Our next panelist is Kristi Davis from Texas. And Kristi is also an abandoned spouse who's standing for her marriage and also a child of divorce. So we'll hear what Kristi has to say.
First, I just want to thank you, Dr. Morris, for allowing me the opportunity to share. It is very difficult, and so many things I've heard today, I just keep nodding my head, yes, yes, and there's so much of this that the public doesn't know, so thank you, everybody, for being here and for sharing your part that you know. So let me tell you a little bit about my story. I am, unfortunately, an expert in divorce. I'm not a professor or a professional in that way, but I've been dealing with divorce for over 40 years. And I have experienced divorce three times in my life. First, my own parents were divorced just before my second birthday, so I have no memories in my life of anything that did not involve divorce. Every memory I have involves divorce. My dad went on to remarry my stepmom, and 10 years later, my mom also remarried to my stepdad. And unfortunately, their marriage didn't last either, and they were divorced a month before my own wedding. So I went into my wedding that whole month before my wedding, which is awful. As I just kept thinking, should I even do this? If this is how it works out, you know, having to deal with all the trust issues. And I don't want children to be raised in this kind of environment, so should I even do this? But then I thought, well, I'm a Christian. My husband's a Christian. So whatever we face in life and in marriage, we'll just deal with it. We'll work through it together. We've got the Lord on our side, and it'll all be okay. But unfortunately, after 17 years of very difficult marriage, my husband decided he wanted a divorce. We had originally separated for the purpose of working on our relationship, and he asked to extend that separation. This led to about 6 to 8 months of almost no communication with him or his family, and I finally just broke down and called his dad and said, help, I need some information, what is going on? And then a few months later, my husband told me he wanted a divorce. So we went through several months of negotiation, pretty much had everything prepared and ready to go for the divorce to be final. We did everything outside of court, which I was very, very grateful for. And then he decided to take our family to court. And then came a very ugly custody battle that lasted for quite a while. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in just a minute. But anyway, so the separation process went on for about 3.5 years. And that's how long it took to get through it. So I'm going to share today a little bit of what I've learned the hard way about divorce and family court in particular. No one certainly studies manuals on this stuff. It's just a trial by fire. As soon as you're in the middle of it, you're having to go through it, deal with the emotional upset, and learn the process at the same time. And the things that I've learned were just devastating. I had no idea that even though my parents had divorced, that this was what the process was really like. So here are 10 common misconceptions about divorce and family court. First, it's just a divorce. Misconception number one is just a divorce. Make no mistake, a divorce is a lawsuit. As soon as your spouse files for divorce, you are being sued. Our society generally doesn't see it like that. People see it more like a wedding in reverse, like it's a personal, private event that you just go to settle some differences, but it's not. Biblically speaking, husbands and wives are joined together by God. A legal divorce is not recognized by God, but he does see all subsequent relationships as adultery, according to Jesus' words. So can we say to God, it's just a divorce? No, I don't think so. Misconception number two, even in no-fault divorce cases, this is a real legal battle. And Dr. Baskerville already went through that thoroughly, but it bears repeating. As soon as somebody files for no-fault divorce, the case is already over. If you're the plaintiff, which they call the petitioner in family court, you've already won. So that means before the defendant, also called the respondent in family court, even knows they've been sued, they've already lost. The rest is really just a sham trial, a clerical or administrative task to divide up assets and talk about custody of children. Clearly, this is an indication of faulty laws that absolutely need to be changed. So to sum it up just really quickly, in no-fault divorce, you are being sued, but you are accused of nothing. Your spouse, who is the one bringing the suit, makes a claim that the marriage is insupportable, which they are the ones fulfilling. So they fulfill the claim, and they win every single time. Then they are rewarded with half of everything you own, at least, including the children. And there's nothing that you or your children can do to stop it. Judges can deny divorce, but they don't. Misconception number three, it takes two to get a divorce. With the exception of South Dakota and Mississippi, no-fault divorces in our country are unilateral, meaning one person wants it and the other one doesn't, and it still goes through, regardless of what the other spouse thinks. So in other words, love and faithfulness are disdained in our current family law system, while adultery and betrayal are, in essence, rewarded. I was told by one attorney in the process, even if your husband commits adultery, the judge won't care. It will make no difference. The wishes of the children are not considered either. Misconception number four, your privacy will be protected. Divorce cases are a matter of public record, like it or not. Even if you don't want the divorce, it's still out there. So this record is going to include the reason for your divorce or insupportability, if there's no reason, your children's information, your custody schedules, your child support arrangements, division of the marital assets. Misconception number five, each judge will impart the same outcome if given the same case. This simply isn't true. Upon filing for divorce, your case automatically is assigned to a judge and you have no say-so in which judge is going to hear your case. Outcomes will vary wildly from courtroom to courtroom, even in the same county. Filing for divorce is like playing Russian roulette with your family. It's especially difficult when you're the one who wants to stand for your family and your spouse is the one taking you to court because you know your family is now in the hands of somebody else who doesn't even know you. Misconception number six, there isn't much risk involved in filing for divorce. This is sort of the common cultural understanding. That's no big deal. So-and-so has done it. Lots of people have done it. Or their own parents have done it. Well, just do divorce. Husbands and wives will often slander their spouses to get an upper hand in court. Perjury is very common and is rarely called out or punished, and the results of that are disastrous. In taking your family to court, you are putting your future and the future of your children in the hands of a stranger, and that's the judge. In family court, judges can grant custody to the other party, force you to sell your house, even tell you where you can and cannot live. In my own case, my husband's attorney tried to ask the judge to force me to work full-time, even though I was working part-time successfully. Luckily, the judge saw right through that. In my own county, there's another woman who went through the courts there, and her husband was actually the one who filed for divorce, and she was required to live within a 5-mile radius of her husband's home, her husband's new home. So the judge forced her to sell her house and move, which was the longtime family home, because she lived 1 mile outside of that 5-mile radius. That's just an example. Misconception number seven, everyone will do what is in the best interest of your children. I thought attorneys will do what's in the best interest of your children. But by and large, the attorney's main focus is how much money they can make off your case. Attorneys are a business, a very powerful, big business, and they are the folks who originally went to the state legislatures and asked for no-fault divorce in the first place. Attorneys are not only the ones who try the cases, they're usually also the family court judges, they're the lawmakers, they are also the disciplinary oversight for their other judge friends. Don't make any mistake, divorce is their ball game and the families are the visiting team. Attorneys see cases day after day, week after week. It's just daily business for them. Sometimes they forget they're dealing with your life, your family. What they consider common, we hold sacred, and that is the family. Remember that before you ever go into a family attorney's office. Attorneys will often also drum up more discord and conflict between the parties. Buyer beware. My spouse, this is what I thought, my spouse will do what's in the best interest of my children. It's heartbreaking to hear, but the very spouse who has turned on you is also very capable of turning on your children, especially if they are emotionally entangled in a new relationship. Once a spouse has hooked up with someone else, that new person will often manipulate them, trying to get them to prefer them over their children or their children over the spouse's children. We are already having to deal with that in my own family. It's heartbreaking. The courts, I thought, will do what's in the best interest of my children. Well, the courts will never know your children like you do. Their statutes are very vague. They're not well defined, and that leaves them able to just make it what they want it to be. So I highly recommend, if you find yourself going through family court, especially if you don't want it, go to mediation and decide amongst yourselves as much as you can. And also, if you are going through no-fault divorce and you don't want it and you're in mediation, have them remove the reference to no-fault divorce from your mediation papers. Misconception number 8, this will not affect other areas of my life. Make no mistake, divorce affects every area of a person's life for the rest of their lives. Like I said, I've been dealing with this for over 40 years myself. In my own life, I still deal with my parents' divorce to this day. We have to make double plans for visiting on holidays, and I still don't see my dad as much as I like. And I just want to clarify, that has nothing to do with my mom. My parents were never the kind to keep the kids away from each other. It's just the way it's turned out. I still have to fight against the instant anxiety that tends to creep up because of a lifetime of rejection and abandonment. All the things that have been talked about with the triggers and so on is so very real. I've had to answer my children's hard questions. Why are grandma and grandpa not living in the same house? Why do we have more grandparents than our friends? Why is dad living with his girlfriend if that's not okay for us to do? Decisions that were made long before they were born affect them. It is multi-generational. I've lost my husband, and according to scripture, I've lost half my flesh. I've lost people in my life that I had received as family. I've lost friends as I continue to stand for my marriage, surprisingly so, even in the church. I've lost all of my savings, and I'm still in debt. And for a time, while my husband tried to take custody of the children, I lost my children. My reputation was trashed, my health was deteriorated, and I've fought severe depression multiple times. And for the third time in my life, I've lost my identity. Culturally speaking, I'm no longer a wife. My children have lost the security of growing up in an intact home, and in a very real way, they've lost their childhood. After divorce is finalized, it's still never really done. Any parent with minor children at home can be taken back to court anytime for any reason concerning those children, as Al was just speaking about in his own case. And then it ripples out and affects the whole of society. Statistically, children raised in broken homes are more susceptible to rebellion, depression, suicide, drug and alcohol use, teen pregnancy, abortion, violence, human trafficking, and spending time in jail. Divorce is a forerunner and a contributor to every major ill in our society. Divorce is the cultural cancer of our day. Misconception number 9, God is okay with divorce. I think the church today is virtually indistinguishable from mainstream society when it comes to holding marriage sacred. This simply should not be. We are largely failing in that area. Marriage is God's idea, and as his children, we are called to be his image bearers in the earth. When we do marriage his way, one man and one woman for life, we are showing the world what it's like to be the bridegroom of our Savior, Jesus Christ. He is faithful. He never leaves us or forsakes us, so why should we leave or forsake one another? Who wants a Savior that will only help them if they perform well enough? Is that not the exact opposite of the gospel message? Divorce is ruining our witness for Christ. Specifically concerning marriage, let Jesus' own words be our guide. When the Pharisees asked him, "Well, Moses permitted divorce," he replied, "It's because your hearts were hard. They are no longer two but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." And concerning taking your brother or sister to court, your Christian brother or sister to court, Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 6, and these are his words. "One brother takes another to court, and this in front of unbelievers. The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means that you have been completely defeated already. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your own brothers and sisters." To quote my pastor, God's word isn't old-fashioned, it's well-fashioned. One day we will all have to give an account for our lives. God is not going to ask me Did your husband love you? He's going to ask me, did you love your husband? Misconception number 10, there is nothing we can do about all of this. There is hope. That's the good news. There's so much we can do to turn the tide. Thinking about what Layla was sharing about the number of divorced children alone, if we were all marching in the same direction, just like Dr. Morris was saying last night, the impact we could have is just, it would be amazing. So number one, we have to work with our state legislatures to change the current laws, keeping the fault-based laws, but repealing the unilateral no-fault divorce laws, because it's simply unconstitutional. The legislatures, I believe, need to have a legal separation option. That way, if you do have difficulty in marriage and you need legal protection, if your safety is at risk or you're financially at risk for your spouse to do something that would be financially harmful, that having a legal separation option allows you to still stand for your divorce instead of divorce being the only option. It sends the wrong message to your spouse if you're wanting to stand. The waiting period needs to be raised to a minimum of 1 year. This would decrease the number of couples that end up divorcing, giving them more time to reconcile. Perjury in family court needs to be punished. And churches can establish hearings done by their leaders to settle disputes within the church. There's one church I know of called Oak Cliff Bible Church in Dallas that does this. I've never seen it myself, but I'm going to go see it. I want to see this in action. There are also documents available that are legally binding that go above and beyond what the state standards say. For example, Mary's Advocates has put together an excellent document like this called True Marriage Proclamation Set. You can find this on marysadvocates.org, their website. Also, we can encourage people going through divorce to stand for their marriage and certainly support them through the difficulty, simply validating. This is really, really hard. And to reconcile if they can. And lastly, and most importantly, we can stand for our own families and marriages and resolve to do marriage God's way. God can be trusted. Trust and obedience go hand in hand. We can choose to solve our problems and love one another as Christ loves us. Even if the rest of the world rejects God's word, we can draw a line in the sand and say boldly, not on my watch and not in my family. And we can change our family legacy for our children by setting that uncompromising example for them to follow. Folks who stand for the sanctity of godly marriage are the family pioneers of our day. We need people like this to show us the way back to healthy family structure done God's way. Thank you.